إن شاء الله. I'm actually looking at you guys' comments for a change, so. All right. We hit 4:32. All right. Assalamu alaikum, guys. Okay. So, inshallah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So, we're in Juz 12, and subhanAllah, this is particularly beautiful, obviously, because we get to scratch the surface with Surah Yusuf. We get to start with Surah Yusuf in Juz 12. But before we do that, inshallah, just to recap, Juz 11, we finished with the end of a Tawbah, we finished with Surah Yunus, and we get into Surah Hud. Surah At-Tawbah, obviously, as we said, was completely Madani, and then it took us back to the end of Mecca. So everything here, these surahs, the sequence of surahs, came to the Prophet ﷺ to give him some perspective on what he was facing in Mecca, and to give the believers as well some perspective, and obviously to serve as a warning to those that were turning the Prophet ﷺ out and turning the the believers out of Mecca and oppressing them. So this surah, this chapter has a lot of perspective, and it comes with a lot. But subhanAllah, I want to point out to you guys just a couple of gems just to start with. If you look at Surah Yunus, and you look at Surah Hud, and you look at Surah Yusuf, all three of those surahs begin with an ayah about the Qur'an. So all three of those surahs begin with an ayah about the Qur'an. So we mentioned Surah Yunus, Alif Lam Ra, Tilka Ayatul Kitab Al-Hakim. The first verse of Surah Yunus is that these are the verses of the wise book. So Allah alludes to the wisdom of the book. Tilka ayatul kitab al-hakim. In Surah Hud, the next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif lam ra. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives some more details into what exactly that hikmah means. Kitabun uhkimat ayatuhu thumma fussilat min ladun hakim and khabir. So it is a book whose verses were perfected and then presented in detail from one who is wise and acquainted. So in Surah Yunus, Allah alludes to the source, that the source of this book is wisdom, that the verses are of wisdom. In Surah Hud, the next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how perfected the verses are and then how they were presented as well in detail from one who is wise and acquainted. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alludes to his wisdom, and he alludes to the presentation, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the book. And then the next surah, which is Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Ra, Tilka Ayatul Kitab al-Mubin, that these are the verses of the clear book. So I'm going to say this again, alright? Surah Yunus, Allah alludes to the wisdom. Surah Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alludes to the wisdom and the presentation. And then Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala focuses on the clarity, the presentation of it. So it's interesting because you have a smooth transition point. And obviously all three of these surahs also start off with Alif Lam Ra. And there have been many, many, many attempts to try to understand the wisdom of Alif Lam Ra in particular, or the muqatti'at, the disjointed letters in general. But subhanAllah, it's obviously... there obviously is a connection that all three of these surahs start off with the exact same disconnected letters in Alif, Lam, Ra. So there's a connection between these surahs in the way they start and explaining the Qur'an, in the tone that they have, in the time period that they were revealed. These were the most difficult moments of the Prophet ﷺ's life. Now, we said about Surah Hud in particular, all right? Surah Hud in particular. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu noticed that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had some gray hairs popping up all of a sudden. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, qad asra' ilayka shayb. O Messenger of Allah, we've noticed that that there is gray hair that's suddenly overcoming you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Shayyabatni Hud wa akhawatuha. Hud and its sisters gave me gray hair. What about Surah Hud in particular? Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, the most difficult ayah that was ever revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Surah Hud was فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتْ وَمَنْ تَابَ مَعَكْ وَلَا تَطْغَوْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so stay firm as you have been commanded and those who have turned back with you as well. So you and the believers, stay firm on the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَطْغَوْا, and do not turn away. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware of all that you do. So this was the most difficult ayah. Allah, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, there was never an ayah that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that was more severe, okay, and more troubling to him than this particular verse. Because this is a warning to the believers themselves. You see, there's a warning to those that are turning away the Prophet ﷺ and those that are turning away the believers, and a warning of punishment to them. And this is a dominant theme in how Allah addresses them in this situation, because it's the last call to them. It's the last warning to them. But then there's the warning to the believers themselves to stay firm. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is warning the Prophet ﷺ, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتِ, you stay firm as you've been commanded. You're going to go through Ta'if, you're going to go through the death of Khadija radiallahu anha, the death of Abu Talib, the persecution's only going to increase. Stay put, stay firm as Allah commanded you, and those who have turned to Allah as well, the repenters and the believers as well. So the threat or the admonishing is to the believers themselves, that don't buckle to the pressure that you are now facing on the outside. So subhanAllah, this ayah, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, out of all the ayat that made the Prophet ﷺ cry, we mentioned Surah An-Nisa, the verses that made the Prophet ﷺ's eyes well with tears, right? So the verse, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا, where Allah mentions him bringing the Prophet ﷺ as a witness upon all of the nations. But here the warning is to the Prophet ﷺ and to the believers themselves. So this is the most difficult ayah and of the most difficult surahs. What are the sisters of Hud? When the Prophet ﷺ says, شَيِّبَتْنِي هُود وَأَخَوَاتُهَا, that Hud turned my hair gray and its sisters. The sisters of Hud, in another hadith which is also authentic, the Prophet ﷺ said, are الْوَاقِعَ الْمُرْسَلَاتِ النَّبَى and التَّكْوِيرِ. Al-Waqi'a, Surah Al-Mursalat, Al-Naba, and Al-Takwir. Why? Because these four surahs are like Surah Hud, okay? In that they detail the punishment and they detail the Day of Judgment and the scene on the Day of Judgment that is a very traumatic scene. So the Prophet ﷺ said these four surahs are the sisters of Hud. They are the akhawat, the sisters of Surah Hud. So Surah Hud is a difficult surah on the Prophet ﷺ, and it contains the most difficult ayah ever revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah goes through the stories of many, many prophets, particularly the prophets whose nations were destroyed. So all of the prophets that Allah mentions in this surah, and He mentions them in succession, are prophets whose nations were destroyed. And of course, this was a warning to Quraysh, and the Prophet ﷺ did not want to see his people in Mecca being destroyed. So who is the first nation? What's the first nation on earth that was destroyed? Okay, you guys think about it. What's the first nation on earth that was destroyed? Let me see if I can find it in the comments, inshallah. I'm actually going to look at the comments. The first nation, the first people that committed shirk, and the first nation that was actually destroyed. Does anyone know? Nuh alayhi salam. Very good. So the people of Nuh alayhi salam. So even though it's called Surah Hud, Noah is the first story, the story of Nuh alayhi salam. And particularly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the challenge of the people of Nuh alayhi salam to him to bring the punishment of Allah. So before Hud is even spoken about, Nuh alayhi salam is spoken about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verses 25 to 35, He mentions the address of Nuh alayhi salam to his qawm when he called upon them, O my people. And he called upon them to worship Allah and to abandon the idols. And his people challenged him. They said, you know what? Go ahead and bring the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأْتِنَا بِمَا تَعِدُنَا. Go ahead and bring it. Stop mocking. Stop telling us about the punishment of Allah. Just go ahead and tell Allah to punish us. We're sick of hearing you. Come to us with your jidal, with your arguments, with your proofs. Just go ahead and bring the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them. So this is a very, very similar situation to Quraysh. They mock the Prophet ﷺ with the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command Nuh alayhi salam to do? He commanded him to build the ark. So the first details of Noah's ark actually come in this surah. The first details of Noah's ark come in this surah between verses 36 and 39. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanding Nuh alayhi salam to build that safina, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would save the people that are with Nuh alayhi salam, and everyone else would be destroyed. Some of the ulama, they said that the number of people on the safina of Nuh alayhi salam are equal to the number of believers that immigrated, that migrated with the Prophet ﷺ to Medina. So some of them actually said there's a parallel here. And there's some riwayat, there's some narrations that could correlate that. Okay, that the number of Meccans, the number of Muslims that went with the Prophet ﷺ in the hijrah to Medina, that made hijrah with him, are equal to the number of people that were with Nuh alayhi salam. So there's a very strong parallel here that only those who are with the Prophet ﷺ would be saved, and everyone else would face, you know, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this situation. So with Nuh alayhi salam, you find the command to build the ark. You find Nuh alayhi salam gathering the people in Surah Hud into the verses that come in the 40s. Nuh alayhi salam gathering the people on his ark. And you also see the dialogue between Nuh alayhi salam and his son, which is the most painful part of this. That your own family refuses to come on board. Your own family refuses to be saved. And this is a very, very difficult situation for Nuh alayhi salam. And it correlates to the most difficult loss to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after Khadija radiallahu anha was Abu Talib. So his own uncle, his own family members. In fact, even the brother of Khadija radiallahu anha was fighting him and oppressing him. His own uncles, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's daughters were engaged to the two children of Abu Lahab, Utbah and Utaybah. And they both, you know, Abu Lahab commanded them both to divorce the daughters of the Prophet ﷺ, or to break the engagement off with Ruqayyah and Kulthum. So the Prophet ﷺ's own two son-in-laws, right, his uncle, all of them are turning away from him alayhi salatu wasalam, and he's appealing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's appealing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Abu Talib. What did he say to Abu Talib? He said, Ya Am, give me, O my uncle, give me one word that I can argue on your behalf on the Day of Judgment with. Just give me that, ilaha illallah, and I can argue on your behalf on the Day of Judgment. So it was the most painful part with the Prophet ﷺ. And here Allah mentions the dialogue between Nuh alayhi salam and his own son. When Nuh alayhi salam is calling his son and telling him to come forth, and his son says, Sa'awi ila jabalin ya'asimuni min al-ma'. He says, no, I'm going to stick to a mountain that will protect me from the flood. So his son staying behind, and the heartbreak of Nuh alayhi salam when he pleads with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in ibni min ahli, that my son is from my family, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling Nuh alayhi salam that his son would be amongst those who would be destroyed. So there's a very close correlation to what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is facing, that his own family members have chosen to turn back and have refused to come on board with him as he makes his hijrah to Medina, as he escapes that persecution. And of course, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes upon them. So Allah first mentions Nuh alayhi salam, the first prophet to call people, or the first prophet who dealt with a generation of shirk, a generation of people associating partners with Allah. Nuh alayhi salam calling his people, and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming to them, including his own son. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Hud alayhi salam. Hud alayhi salam addressing his people, bringing them all sorts of proofs, his people becoming aggressive with him. So from verse 50 to 60, you find Hud alayhi salam. And subhanAllah, it's almost like a set of like 10 ayat or so per prophet. Hud alayhi salam calling upon his people, and his people, and you know, of Ad being so arrogant. SubhanAllah, so arrogant. And the imagery is should not be lost here. Nuh alayhi salam's son is standing on a mountaintop and telling his father that I'm going to stick here because it will save me from the flood. Hud alayhi salam standing on al-Ahqaf, standing on a mountaintop, calling his people and saying nothing is going to save you from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the imagery should not be lost here of the son of Noah and Hud alayhi salam with two opposing messages. And of course, we find with Hud alayhi salam that the punishment of Allah came to his people. So Allah mentions Hud, he mentions the rejection from the people, and he mentions the punishment. Then Allah mentions Salih, and Hud and Salih and Shu'aib, these are the original Arabs. These are the pre-Abraham Arabs. Okay, so these are the original Arabs. So Allah mentions these prophets that are the original Arab. And Salih alayhi salam addressing his people. And just like with Hud alayhi salam, Salih finds rejection. Allah mentions the rejection and Allah mentions the punishment. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you continue onwards, and I'm going to skip a section and I'll come back to it. The ayat between 69 and 77, which talk about Ibrahim alayhi salam, I want to come back to it. Okay, so the theme goes from Hud, then it goes to Salih. Then in verse 77 to 83, it goes to Lut alayhi salam. Lut alayhi salam, calling his people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and warning his people. Lut's people becoming aggressive with him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning their disbelief, and Allah mentions the punishment of the people of Lut alayhi salam. And then Allah mentions from verse 84, Shu'aib alayhi salam, calling his people. Shu'aib's people rejected him, and Allah mentions the consequences. And finally, Allah mentions Fir'aun. Okay? So look, Allah is mentioning, subhanAllah, all these prophets and just quickly giving us a snippet of the call, the response, the punishment. The call, the response, the punishment. And with Fir'aun, very short ayat. Again, about 11 ayat. The call to Fir'aun, the rejection of Fir'aun, the punishment to Fir'aun. And so these are the evil people that are mentioned in succession here, right? And the way that they rejected and they turned away. There is a lot of correlation here. With Fir'aun in particular, Abu Jahl is like Fir'aun. So Abu Jahl is the equivalent of Fir'aun in this ummah. The Prophet ﷺ called him the Pharaoh of this ummah. And subhanAllah, just like with Fir'aun, who would be the first to be humiliated and destroyed by the drowning, by the Red Seas coming upon him, right, and coming upon his army, Abu Jahl would die in the first bunch, in the first batch that would come after the Prophet ﷺ and the believers in the Battle of Badr. So Abu Jahl would be humiliated and disgraced in the same way that Fir'aun was. And so he is, of course, the one who's organizing the boycott, the one who's really, really carrying out oppression at the highest level to the Prophet ﷺ. So throughout Surah Hud, again, there's a prophet that's mentioned, there is the rejection, and then there is the punishment that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only bushra, the only glad tidings that's given in this entire surah, and it's beautiful because it ties into the next surah, is from verse 69 to 76 or 77, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ جَاءَتْ رُسُلُنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ بِالْبُشْرَى قَالُوا سَلَامًا قَالَ سَلَامٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the angels going to the house of Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sarah and giving him the glad tidings of who? Of Ishaq alayhi salam, right? They were on their way to destroy the people of Lut, who are mentioned in the next section here. But on the way to destroy the people of Lut, they met Abraham, they met Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sarah, and they gave Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sarah the glad tidings of who? They gave them the glad tidings of Ishaq and also Yaqub. So Allah mentions, وَامْرَأَتُهُ قَائِمَةٌ فَضَحِكَتْ, that his wife Sarah was standing and she laughed. Whenever the glad tidings came to Ibrahim alayhi salam, she laughed hysterically. And she says, فَبَشَّرْنَاهَا بِإِسْحَاقَ وَمِنْ وَرَاءِ إِسْحَاقَ يَعْقُوبُ. We gave her the glad tidings of Ishaq, and after Ishaq, Ya'qub. We gave Ibrahim and Sarah the glad tidings of Abraham and of Jacob. And the next surah is now Jacob and his son, Ya'qub and Yusuf. So subhanAllah, the only bushra that we find in this entire surah is the bushra, the glad tiding of Ya'qub alayhi salam. And Ya'qub alayhi salam is a heavy subject matter in the next surah, which is about his son Yusuf alayhi salam.